Hi. What's up? Cool. I don't have to talk about anything because he just said it all. Technology is working. This is a Dali painting. I titled this Room with a View, and I thought that was kind of cool. All right, carry on. I grew up in Minnesota, all right. Surprise, surprise, we had a cabin on a lake, so I spent a lot of time there. But that's kind of where I cut my teeth. My family, every summer in my youth, we would travel to a different national park in the West. We started in the Badlands, and the drives got further and further as we got older and older. So I had been to most of the national parks west of the Mississippi by the time I had graduated high school. Carry on. Throughout these national park experiences, we just started hiking, and then as I got older, I started scrambling and carrying cool sticks around. And then I started rock climbing, and I became kind of interested in the more vertical world. And as I got more interested in the vertical world, I realized that I fucking loved it. It's pretty awesome. Rock climbing is great. But I didn't know anything about it, how to tie a knot, any of that jazz. So my parents, for Christmas, bought me a John Long book and a rope and some quick draws, and I was a freshman in high school, and I was in Minnesota. So I practiced tying knots a lot, and I read the book over and over and over, until I moved to Colorado when I was a freshman in college. I came to the YMCA of the Rockies as a freshman in college and worked as an adventure counselor. I worked with high schoolers, taking them out and doing mountain biking and rock climbing and water rafting and all sorts of stuff. And eventually started working for a company called Kent Mountain Adventure Center, guiding high school and middle school kids, mostly from the Denver area, on wilderness experiences. Because mine was so formative as a youth, I really wanted to infect others with the love and the joy that the wild places can bring you externally, but also inside your own mind. As Dr. Berliner mentioned, I also started a company called Dovetail Mountain Adventures. So I took people on weekend yoga and rock climbing retreats. Essentially, my bachelor's degree is in psychology and my master's is as well. So I was also intrigued with how we access fear. And I figured that yoga was a really good platform and beginning space for introducing people to rock climbing, and as opposed to the other way around. I also noticed that like my dirtbag climbing friends weren't going to pay for a yoga retreat, but yoga people would pay for a climbing retreat. So essentially, these weekends, you spend a whole weekend. We do on Saturday, we do all these uncomfortable yoga poses, inversions, handstands, all that kind of stuff, and get you uncomfortable and learning how to find comfort in that uncomfort, finding breath and just space to realize that, like, this sucks, but it only has to suck right now. And then later in the afternoon, we take in climbing, and it was really cool to see, in comparison from the just traditional guiding that I'd done, when people would freak out 5 feet off the ground, or like Dr. Berliner's young son the other day, he wanted to get down, and Dr. Berliner said, well, you haven't even gotten up yet. Taking them from that initial guiding experience into this mode where people were successful. Every single person got to the top, no bitching at all, no complaints. Like, they might have hung on the rope and acknowledged that they had fear, but then they sat with it and realized, I'm okay, and kept going up. And I thought that was really cool. And it, ooh, that's fake, by the way. I know, isn't that good? In addition to Dovetail Mountain, I decided that all this time in the wilderness, I should probably it would probably be wise if I had some wilderness medicine training. So I took an EMT course, a wilderness EMT course with Remote Medical. They're based out of Seattle. And I had such a good time in that course that I applied for a job and I got a job with them. And so this is just recreating some burns. I make a really good placenta, by the way. And then eventually I got a job as a climbing ranger. Five of us in this photo are climbing rangers, and the other few are from Colorado Mountain School. We were doing a team training. And I worked as a climbing ranger in Rocky Mountain National Park for the last 5 years, doing technical rescue. Essentially, I would describe my job as an EMT. You're usually just in the at the hospital or near or at your house. So you have like a house that they put everyone in, and you're waiting for a phone call. In Rocky, what happens is that we're just wandering the woods, essentially, waiting for that phone call. So I average like 30 to 60 miles a week of hiking around the park and just waiting for any kind of rescue that may happen. And if there's not one happening, I'm talking to park visitors and trying to do some preventative search and rescue, telling them that they should not be hiking up longs in their Keds with their McDonald's at 2 p.m. with the rolling dark thunderstorms. Joy! Why so much about joy? Like, why is the outdoors, why does it bring so much joy? For me, as our first presenter mentioned, it does. It brings me into that psychological and physical state, that flow state. When I'm climbing something difficult, like this is one of the harder trad lines I've ever done on Lumpy Ridge. It's called Dakota. I aid climbed this, when I first moved to Estes as kind of just a test piece to see if I could aid climb it, and then to come back 5 years later and be like, I want to try to free climb that. That was pretty groovy. Wilderness also lets you become comfortable in uncomfortable terrain. This is on Half Dome in Yosemite. And as we've seen this mountain before today, this is like my backyard and my favorite place in the world. This is on a route on Chasm View Wall, which is in the Chasm Cirque of Long's Peak, and the diamond is in the background. This is the last pitch of the nose on El Capitan. This was taken in 2012 when I set the speed record for the first time with a partner. Oh, and this is also one of my favorite places in the world. This should be a video. We can press play. So playing in the wilderness, it lets you find comfort in this and calm eyes in like a hectic and uncomfortable space. So this is on a mountain called Saint Exupery in Patagonia, which is in southern Argentina. And what's really cool about this spot is that to my right, upward of the screen, is a mountain called Fitzroy. And then behind me, you'll see this really crazy piece of Cerro Torre. Yeah. Behind that mountain is an ice cap, and so that snow cone, it just turns into a snow cone. This is in Zion. Last spring, maybe 6 months before my accident, I decided I would try, I don't know, in climbing I was trying to do all sorts of them, all the activities. Like I was trying to be okay at bouldering, but trying to be a good alpinist and trying to be a good trad climber and sport climber and aid climber. I was trying to tick all the boxes. And so this is after rope soloing a wall called Touchstone Wall. And I thought that was kind of a cool photo because I did it solo and there's the very top. Aha. Do you guys, anybody have Patagonia jackets tonight? Yeah, so that mountain range, that's this mountain. Fitzroy.
Hey.
Hey.
What's up?
Hey. We're on the summit.
Summit of what? What we just do?
A new route.
A new route.
That's that Cerro Torre mountain. So this is the top of Fitzroy. That's Fitzroy right there. How cool is that? That's after doing a new route on Fitzroy, which is in Argentina. Okay. The Colorado route. Yeah. And so wilderness also is just about perspective, right? So as I said, if you can get upside down, or if you can see things from a new perspective, or if you can get used to doing things in a different, getting uncomfortable in situations that might not be the most comfortable. This is doing a handstand on the top of Bugaboo Spire in Canada. I like to do handstands. And as far as my work, all of this personal experience, I felt like gave me a lot of tangible experience to take to work. All of this finding that calm in stressful situations. So this is on, can anyone name this lake in Rocky Mountain National Park? It's a weird view. That's Sky Pond. So this is the Petit Groupon. There's this lovely, very popular 5'8 rock climbing route that's there. This guy accidentally fell. He was quite a few pitches up, and he fell and broke both of his legs. And this was actually the day of the eclipse. It was kind of a cool day to be out. He fell, broke both his legs. He had spent the night before, and some of our rescues stayed the night with him, and then we rigged this highline to get him. This was another rescue, similar thing on Twin Sisters Mountain, which is just outside of the park. And so not only did Rocky respond, but there's lots of other responders like Larimer County and Boulder County both responded to this. Go ahead. Oh, this is a video, so press play, please. This is an actual rescue happening. This is me flying an 18-year-old kid. This is in the beginning of the season, so this is the alluvial fan in Rocky Mountain National Park. This kid had walked 100 feet from the parking lot, scrambled on some boulders, and then jumped across the river. But he jumped downhill, so when he turned around, he couldn't get back over. Back, he couldn't reverse his jump, and the river in the spring was a little bit too much. And the slope that the side that he had jumped to, if you've ever been to the alluvial fan, it was a flooded area in like 1980. And so the side that he was on was like a vertical chossy slope of loose sand and rock. So he couldn't crawl out or get back across. And so what we're doing here is we created a high line, essentially a zip line, essentially, that like went across, spans the gap. And then I'm being lowered.
Yep.
To the other side of the river, where I have with me an extra harness, and then I will put it on the patient and strap him in and move him up a little bit. It was pretty awesome, in fact, because his dad is the person that you think you can maybe see in the red on the other side of the river, and his dad was like, yeah, yeah, he should just spend the night. So we were able to throw a sleeping bag to him, and that's the kid down there, so he just spent the night, and he's fine with the raging river in his ear. This is back to that Twin Sisters rescue. And so what happens with that, because this guy also had a broken leg, we loaded him into the litter there, and then we do what's called a short haul. So he is being lifted up from the ground and into the helicopter. Go ahead. So I want to pose to you guys, What happens when we have one of these life-altering moments and our perspective changes? That's what happened to me on October 11th, 2017. I was climbing, this was probably like my 10th or 12th time climbing the nose on El Capitan, and this is in California. I fell from the boot flake, and I cratered into a feature called the Texas flake. This is a little bit better view. Oh, yeah. So the high point is about where the red arrow was. My last piece of protection is where the yellow, and then I fell all the way down to the green. So I fell like 120-some feet. And this is me being short-hauled off of El Cap, just like what I was doing for my job. This rescuer here is Brandon Latham. He actually worked in Rocky Mountain National Park, so I knew who he was. And this is what happened. I had a T12 burst fracture, L4 compression fracture, 4 broken ribs, lots of hematomas all over the place. I have lost my sense of smell. My scapula, I think, took the brunt of the force. I now have my railroad tracks, I affectionately call them, from T9 to L3. And a shit ton of nerve pain. But I'm here. And I know who I am. On that depressing note, we're going to do the thing that Quinn likes to do best, is get some audience interaction. So can everyone stand up? Spread out a little bit. Give yourself some room. Oh, yeah, this is going to be great. All right, you guys love me. All right, I would love, we're going to do a little my little yoga time. So if I can get everyone to reach their hands up. Yeah, give a nice stretch, nice deep breath, and then you're going to slowly bend over all the way. Soften the knees. Let your head hang between your head. Relax your jaw. Really, shake your head. Yes, yeah, I see all these stiff necks. Come on, let your head hang. There we go. Do you feel uncomfortable or vulnerable right now? Think to yourself. All right, I'd like you to stay where you are. And now that we've settled that you are uncomfortable and maybe slightly vulnerable, but willing to be open to the world, turn to a neighbor with the same position that you were in and give them a what's up. Maybe you're looking through your legs. Yeah. Nice work, everyone. Slowly back up, no head rushes. Have a seat. Thank you for humoring me. So I was speaking to perspective. That's what I've been doing for the last year, has been staring at asses. Seriously. I'm really glad I don't have that sense of smell. It's not been fun. Okay. So, my struggle in the last year has been how to find that joy again. Knowing that I love playing outside so much and being playful with people so much, I might have a new mode of transportation. But this, the desire and the same goals are there, to play outside. Yeah, so this is just getting started with some of the trails in Rocky Mountain National Park. Yeah, seeing people on the trail and saying that I'm inspiring is not the best word. Because I'm just trying to get after what my normal is. This is a really cool machine that this guy in Crested Butte makes for para athletes to bike around in. This is in Zion National Park, again, another place that I love so much. It's quite bittersweet to return here. But if you see me on a trail in any national park, this is okay for me to be on because this is how it is my way of accessing that trail. I've been climbing again. It's pretty groovy. I do lots of pull-ups. That's all I do. Oh, this is a video. So what I've realized in my adventures now is that I need people. And that makes me uncomfortable. And to ask for help, I feel really vulnerable. So in a day like this, I biked up Fall River Road, which is 9 miles uphill. I did have friends along, and I find that my friendships, I need people who are accountable, and I need people who are psyched to go outside. And one of my friends is here, Carl. Thanks for coming. So what we did is we just did I use a lot of climbing rigging for my life now, like to get my wheelchair in. I have a 2-to-1 to get my wheelchair in my van. And for this experience, I had 3 friends along, but we just tied a rope from me, the front of my bike, to the back of their bike, their seat post, and they just rotated. So every 3 miles, one of them would, every 3 miles, one of them would take over. And so that 9 miles uphill, they just each had to help with 3 miles of just a little extra quad workout for them, but it kept us at a more reasonable pace rather than me just crawling with my hands the whole way. And so we went up Fall River Road, then up and over Trail Ridge and down, and that was pretty awesome. So this is a little video of just kind of all the adventures that I've had some friends who are really psyched on, and the ways that we're making it work with the tools that we have.
10,000, but up we go.
Up we go.
I was probably supposed to talk about this earlier, but this was my first adventure back to the mountains. This is off the Fall River Road off I-70, I think, St. Mary's Glacier. A dog leash because we weren't really that prepared. And he slipped off the back.
Angels on the sideline.
Leg braces that help me walk around or stand up from time to time and help me get out of the
walk.
So finding purpose again, that's also something that is coming along with this injury. Go ahead. Before my accident, I traveled to Washington, D.C. For an event called Climb the Hill, where a whole bunch of climbers went and spoke to our people in office about the importance of public lands. And so in 2018, I returned. I might have had a different look to me, but I spoke to the same things, just the importance of these places, not only for recreation, but for economic growth and thriving in economic growth and the future, like how formative it was for me and how it needs to be preserved for our future. With that, even with this new perspective, the value of moving through wild places, outdoors and inside ourselves, is integral to who we are. And with that, I want to leave you guys with, I like what you said. We're going to get a little paradoxical and keep it weird. So let's keep it weird, guys. Let's get dancing. Press play.